as we work our way around and show you the mobile home park. But this stretches completely off to the west, up the hill. So right now it's really blazing out here, being pushed by the wind. TV5 copy. As we continue around here, we're just getting our first look at it, as you are. Helicopters down low. Cal Fire is out here with fixed wing, and this thing is going uphill. So it's being and so it's really causing issues here, because you have now the wind driven, and you also have the terrain driven on this fire. So they got two things working against them, and this fire down in that mobile home park is really just consuming everything in its way. We have a helicopter coming in for a drop here on the east end of the mobile home park. You see it right there. They're hitting in there close with those helicopters. But you can see how he's crabbing and how he's just swinging around. That's how much wind is down there, how much these helicopters are having to deal with down there. So right now, it's really working its way through there, taking out structures as it goes. But again, it has really worked its way up the hill. And I'm going to estimate it now at well over 20 acres, because now I'm getting a little bit of a look at it as we come up the west or the south side of the fire here. And I'm getting peeks through the smoke. And it is screaming up this hill and over the hill. And I'm looking ahead, and there looks like there is some civilization off to the west. I really can't tell you which one it is, because there's just so much smoke down there. But right now, as we work our way around the fire, it is really just out of control. Cal Fire doing everything they can to stop it. I see FOS check lines down there, which means they do have the fixed wing on scene trying to stop it and direct it away. But right now, it is a firefight by the helicopters down below. And right now, their main concern, big concern, is that mobile home park down here, where that fire is just ripping through it as we watch it burn here in Calimesa. Right, you can't get ahead of this. I mean, the wind is blowing so hard and pushing so fast through there, and those mobile homes are very susceptible to fire. So when they start going, there's really little you can do about it, is just try to keep the ones around it from burning. But you can see how much damage is done here. It just got into the first one and just started racing its way through the mobile home park. And like I said, yeah, once it gets into a mobile home, you got one right here on the edge starting to burn just a bit there, and the more over here lost on the south border of the mobile home park. And that one right there is starting to take off as well. So the best they can do is try to get in there, protect the ones that are not burning, just let the ones that are in there keep it, try to cool it down to keep it from getting in to any more. But man, this is very, very hard. Now with firefighters, the wind is always the enemy on this. Back last year when we had the Thomas fire, that was the wind that really took that thing and ran it so far, so fast that firefighters couldn't get ahead of it. Because the problem is, it's just running so fast, all they can do is flank it and try to protect things along the side. You do not want to get in front of a fire like this, because there's no way you can protect yourself, because it could switch at any moment. It could come up a canyon and turn on you and come around behind you. So they really have to be very careful on these wind-driven fires like this one, because it's fire dynamic and fire activity. It's just very, very unpredictable at times because of these gusts coming down through the canyons. And because of the canyons and the terrain, it can change directions at a moment's notice. But right here, you see a simple grass fire just worked its way up very quickly, got into the mobile home park, started burning through there, and is stretching out to the west up over the hill here. We're just on the north side of the 10 freeway right here at Sandalwood, as we said. And so right now, so you see it's burning up in the grass there and up over the hill. And so now they're dealing with that as well. Then the structure protection units are down there in the mobile home park trying to work it. So all out firefight from the sky. Guys on the ground are just doing whatever they can do to slow it down, to steer it, and try to keep it away from any type of residential property that they have out here. But right now there's so much smoke in the path of this fire, it's hard for us to pick it out. There's the 10 freeway right to the north of the fire. And you can see the industrial area right there. It's kind of going around that as well. And there's a hill just in that smoke column. And so it'll work its way up that hill, and has already stretched, I would say, at least 20 acres up that hill, and pushing as fast as it can go with this wind and terrain. Unfortunately, Lou, I can hear you asking questions, but I can't hear you too well here. Let me get turned around. Maybe I can pick a signal up a little better here. If you're asking a question, can you try that one more time? I think by the time we got here, that was already done deal. I mean, this type of fire coming so fast, there's no time to pack up. You just got to go. Get out of the mobile home park. We'll just kind of zoom in here, kind of look around the mobile home park, see if we see all we're going to see is the sheriff's department down here, fire department in between these structures trying to protect them. And as far as evacuations or, hey, let's pack up, get ready to go. This fire, if we zoom out, I'll show you, it's just a grass fire that started probably about 300 yards away right here on this corner, and the wind's going to the west. It just took off and ran through that grass, what we call flash fuels, very quickly. So I don't think these folks in the mobile home park had much of a time to do anything other than just get out of the way. And once that first couple of mobile homes got involved, it's just a domino effect. You can see right here how much fire load is in those mobile homes. And then that just continues on through the different mobile homes down here, and so it's unable to stop it in any way. So as far as going and taking things out, no, it's probably just get in your car and get out as fast as you can, because if you're trapped in the backside of this mobile home park, it would be a bad thing, because it's got it pretty well consumed on the far west corner of it. You see all that black smoke that we can't see through, and down in there it's just solid fire, and when that black smoke is showing, that's telling us that there's plastics and things of that burning, structures and different materials down there versus brush that's more of a gray. But right there you see an engine right on top of that one, trying to put water on it to protect the one that's not on fire, and that's about all they can do. And then once it gets through there, then they'll just kind of go in and try to mop it up and knock out any hot spots. But right now, there's a lot of lost mobile homes as it works its way through. And you see it just shot right through the middle of this and hit several motor homes and just mobile homes, and just left the other ones that there just caught the one on the end. So, yeah, there was nothing getting ahead of this one once it got into mobile homes, and getting out of the way is just a matter of getting your car and leaving. Yeah, that's what they try to prepare you for. If they tell you, you be aware, if they have a high wind event coming, we have low humidity, it's just a perfect recipe for fire. And these people do this for a living. This is what their lives are. This is what they do. And when they give you that warning, you need to really heed to that warning. So right now, you can see, the 7, I got you, I'm on here. And so as you see, this fire started with a simple grass fire. And as you said, it could have been a lawnmower, it could have been a weed clearing situation, but who knows. But it took off, ran about 300 yards, hit the first mobile homes, and then took off through there, and then the embers and the debris coming off those mobile homes went up into the canyon and then up onto the hill. And now with this wind being pushed, you have terrain going uphill, fire moves 16 times faster uphill than it does downhill. It's just, you know, the math is that it, you just can't get out of its way. And they don't have time to come in and protect you when it gets going like this. They're doing their darndest to keep it out of structures, keep it off of other buildings. You see there's a school down here right in the path of the fire, right there on the right side of that smoke column as we fly around. So they're down in their structure protection, and there's only so much resources to go around. We have another fire going on just about 10 miles from here, the Ritchie Fire, and they have resources there fighting that one. So right now, Cal Fire doing everything they can. So if they warn you to get out, get out. I mean, if they warn you to be ready to go, have your things packed, if you're in a type of area like this, you need to be ready to go. So there's no messing around when they give those warnings. They do it out of all the past knowledge, all their experience with these fires. And when the weather condition is like this, it's just bound to happen. We just don't know where it's going to happen. Oh yeah, it when a structure takes off, it starts casting embers downwind. It depends on the wind, how fast it's going, and with a structure fire, you have a lot of heat, so you have a lot of lift. So what they call it ember casting, or firebrands being sent downwind, and they could go as far as a mile if the wind is quick enough. And I referenced the Thomas fire. We had winds on there at 75 to 80 miles an hour, so it was throwing embers out 2 to 3 miles and carrying them up in the smoke column and dropping them even further out. So you had spot fires starting. So it's like somebody going along and just setting fires downwind and just continuing on, and they all then converge together, and then you have one large massive fire. Now with the Woolsey fire, same situation. It was in a canyon area. You had a little bit lower winds on that one, but still you had the Venturi effect in the canyons that speed the winds up, and that thing got into some light brush and then moved into some homes. And once it got into the homes, you just start spreading embers all over that neighborhood, just like here in this mobile home park, and it gets in the eaves, it gets up in the trees, and then starts fires throughout the neighborhood, and the firefighters just can't keep ahead of it. And once the structures get to a point, they move on to protect structures versus trying to knock the fire down, as right here in this mobile home park is a prime example. It was probably just a river of fire going through right through the center of this mobile home park, which stretched through very quickly and then got into the brush on the west side of it. Now they're concerned with the inhabitants on the north side, on the what they call the right flank of this fire as it's moving out the north side. It is really stretch your personnel thin when it's going this fast. And like I said, when the wind is blowing this fast, it's very hard to slow it down or get out in front of it. They just try to direct it away from structures. So they'll start throwing those Foscheck lines in between the fire and buildings to try to steer it into uninhabited areas, because they're not going to put it out. They're just going to try to steer it. And that's what it looked like they tried to do here. But a simple grass fire is caused all this damage right now. You can see it's just burning at will here through this low grass area. Flame lengths are not very high, but they're just a lot of it burning here. And then up in the main part of the fire, I'm sure pretty sure there's a large flame links up in those canyons that's feeding it. And then over the top of the canyon, it'll drop down into there. And then you're going to have the wind coming over the top of these hills, getting into that canyon. And it's going to be like a blast just going right down that canyon. And so the firefighters, no chance to get ahead of this one. Right, as you have the difference in temperatures going on, you have the hotter temperatures in the inland area versus over the ocean, the wind starts moving towards that. But with this wind event and the pressure systems that are around us stirring this wind, it's going to be a pretty heavy deal out here throughout the night, because it's just the way the winds are set up and the way those pressure systems are working through the Southern California area. But yeah, it's if you're living in an area where you have a potential for brush fires, be ready to go. Have all your important documents, all your stuff that you need to live for about 3 to 4 days ready to go, And when that word comes, it don't question it. Just go. And hopefully, these folks here got enough warning, but I don't think it was much to be able to get out of there. And as you said, Glenn, there's only a couple ways out. And this mobile home right here is burning. And next, that one right next to it, just from the radiant heat from it, will soon spark off unless they get a structure protection unit in there. But you have the brush all in front of these mobile homes burning, and it's just so much fire that they don't want to get down in between there. Because let's widen out. Let me show you an example here. So widen out. So right there, stop right there. So you don't really, that fire truck that's going down, fire engine that's going down in there, he's going to have fire on four sides with all this wind going on. He could be very easily stuck in the middle of that, but I'm sure they're keeping a close eye on it. So that's what they got to worry about. They don't want to get themselves stuck in a situation where they have fire on both sides of their escape route. But he's cautiously working his way down here. All this area is completely burned. You have like four here on the left side of the road that hasn't, or five on the left side of the road that burned, but you got one well involved down to the west. Oh, absolutely. Just think about it. You have, a raging fire on either side of you. You have that heat that comes off. You don't have to be even near the flames to get burned. I mean, that's what they have to worry about. So this engine here, he's getting in the middle of it there with a fire on both sides, but he's trying to get in there and protect the occupants in here. But he's got fire on both sides of him right now, so I'm sure they're going to keep a close eye on him, and his captain on that engine is going to watch the fire activity around them. But he's going in there trying to protect those five units that are still there. Now, as we come out, we'll show you the north side of the fire as it works its way up that hill. And like I said, this is on the south side of the 10 freeway. The 10 is not blocked. We heard reports that it was shut down for a bit, but it looks like it's moving, but it's not moving very quickly. But you can see as we're trying to push through that smoke, it's just so dense, and the smoke from that mobile home park is just really covering everything in there. But like I said, this is the steering action they'll try on this side to keep it away from these that college and also the houses that surround that college here on the north side of the fire, which is just on the south side of the 10 freeway, right about Sandalwood. Five's over on the north side of the fire. I'm going to turn back. Five's got both of you. All right. All right. Thank you. got an airdrop going on the north south side. Should be in a right screen, right? Come up. Seven, five, sketch, I'll slow crawl behind you. Five will pick up a right turn with you guys behind seven. I'm going to go ahead and make a turn right. Got BA 146 going right under us. I don't know where he's going though. I guess that's Live Oak Canyon right there, that one back over here. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. We are seeing drops, but they're going right through the smoke, so I haven't really called them out because we really couldn't put them on camera. They have the big jets out here, the BAE 146, dropping its loads along the south side here, trying to keep the fire on in a path up into an area where there is very little inhabitants. You see right here, that part of the fire is where they're using the drops to steer this fire. But that's what those guys are doing. But the firefighters on the ground down here, and then the helicopters are in close, hitting close support for the ground troops that are in here fighting this fire. And let me talk, we talked about, you know, the time these folks had time to get out. You have to think about it. This fire started in a grass fire, like I said, about 300 yards to the north or to the east of the mobile home park. They were probably covered in a thick smoke during the whole time trying to get out of there. So you can imagine the confusion of what was going on this fire at the very beginning. And I see a ST2 making a drop here on the south border of the fire, just kind of zip right out of the smoke. And right there you see the Foscheck coming down. And as you were describing it, Glenn, it's a chemical that goes down to the ground. It attaches to the shrubbery and then dries and makes the shrubbery pretty much fireproof, where the fire will burn up to it and there's no fuel for it to hit, and so they're able to stop it. Now I just saw the DC-10 go underneath me. If we come up and pan to the right, we'll pick up on that DC-10. Now this is the tanker or 10 tanker group out here that comes out of Victorville and also out of San Bernardino Airport. They come in and they'll drop their 12,000 gallons of fire retardant, so they can paint a pretty good line. I'm going to stay over here on the south side of the fire. We won't be able to see too much of the mobile home park because of the smoke. But this tanker here actually, this is a 737. This is one of the newer ones that are here. It's actually a 737 that the Colson Fire Company is working with, and it's going to come around and go over the top of the smoke here and then work this south flank, as we call it, the south flank of the fires. It's trying to paint that line up the hill, but he's coming around taking a look. There's that air attack aircraft overhead that gives him direction, and then he'll pick up what's called a lead aircraft, and that lead aircraft will direct him exactly where they want him to go. I thought that was the 10 going under, but I don't see the engine on the tail, so that's the 737 that has just been brought up into service here recently to augment the firefighting from the air for the Colson Company and also 10 tanker to get the big iron on this fire. And they can lay down a pretty good swath of Foscheck. And as the smaller S2Ts only carry about 1,600 gallons, these will carry upwards of 12,000 gallons for the DC-10. And then these tankers here, probably about 6,000 to 8,000 as they come through. And he's making his turn, coming around from the east. He's probably going to hit this flank. You see that orange line there in the screen near the fire. They drop out in front of the fire and let it burn up to it, because they got to give it time to dry to a point and to coat the shrubbery and take that fuel away from the fires. He's making that left turn, swinging around, and you just have to be in awe. These are passenger aircraft that have been changed and configured to do this kind of work, and the firefighters that fly them are probably former airline pilots who have a lot of experience in this airframe. But to get this type of aircraft down low and slow, not what it's designed for, is just hats off to those pilots to be able to get in there and get tight. So you see him making the turn, starting to descend, getting lined up on the fire line, and once he gets to the point where they want to drop, they'll start releasing Foscheck here. We'll see as he makes its run through, and you see the Foscheck below, and hopefully there it is right there, dumping out from the interior tanks and just painting a line right along, and a very thick drop right there. So that's going to stop the fire in its track here on the south side. That's exactly what they want to do. They're just trying to steer this fire into the uninhabited area of the hillside and stop it from coming down to the south. And fortunately, on the other side, the north side, it's a little tough for them to do it there because there's so much smoke on that side. So right now you have what they call the very large air tankers up here. We have two of them working this fire along with the smaller ones, trying to paint that Foscheck line. But going back to how this fire started, I just can't imagine the amount of smoke that was going over those homes as it burned its way towards them, and those occupants trying to get out of there. But as we've been talking, once it got into those mobile homes, it just raced right through there. And you can see there's still a lot of fire in that park as it burns its way to the west. Well, I don't know the numbers on the 737, but the 747 will get down to 200 feet, and that's very low for a big jet like that. So I'm assuring that these guys are probably down to about 200 feet. They get down to about 140 knots and try to spread that out. They have everything down. They have their flaps and slats down to be able to fly slow. So very, very low for that big of an aircraft. But they're flying light, so they're used to carrying a lot more of a load that they're carrying, so they have a lot of reserve power they can use to fly out of it. But yeah, they're down probably about 200 feet, if I would guesstimate on that, and probably just about 140 more miles an hour, 140 knots going through there to spread that stuff out. But they can't go much slower than that, just from the aerodynamics of the aircraft itself. You know, that's not what it was designed to do. At that speed, it's going to land, is what the engineers did. But these pilots here are able to fly those airframes in a way that they're able to use them for firefighting. They've been configured for this and tested. And they don't bring these things on, just make them and then bring them on. They have to be tested over and over to make sure they're safe. And they've gone through a lot of testing, and they just came online here, the 737, so a great addition to what they call the VLAT, the very large air tankers, to be able to come online here and fight these fires. But right now they're just trying to steer it while the interior groups are trying to knock these fires down and knock this fire down in the mobile home park. So Okay, head to the north here. I don't have you right now. There you are. Moved. I will. Head back south, I got you. Go left, left. Smoke coming out of that one right there. Actually, we were getting a little lucky up here. The wind's blowing very hard, but it's smooth. We're not getting any of the big rolls that we normally get out in this part of the area. Normally, the hills up here will cause it to be very bumpy for us, but I'm just fortunate right now. I'm knocking on wood. It's very smooth, but it's blowing very, very hard on us, so it's causing us to have to fly different ways here to keep the aircraft stable. But yeah, those firefighters down there, I mean, they're dealing with a lot of wind. You saw that flag, as Glenn pointed out, just whipping in the wind, and then little fires popping up around them. That I don't even know if that firefighter on that hose line down there even knows that there is a fire in that home right there next to him. You see a fire hose going between a couple of hoses there, going between the houses, and now fire coming out of the opposite end where we saw that earlier smoke. So right now, hopefully they're making an interior type of attack on this to get up there and try to knock it down. But as we've been speaking, these are very susceptible to fire, and once you get going, it's very hard to stop them. And now you have a very large one right here being impinged upon by the fire around it, getting up under that eave, and eventually this one will be lost as well. So a lot of things going on here, a lot of dynamics set up here to where they're trying to deal with putting the fire out, but then again, trying to make sure that their firefighters are safe, as you said, backing down the roads to be able to drive straight out in a hurry. And now we got a MD-87 coming in from the north here, Colton, gonna make its way around, and more than likely it's gonna come around and go through the same spot of the fire and come down the south portion. But this is another converted passenger aircraft here that has been brought in by the Ericsson company to fight fires, and this one here does the same thing. It'll come around, check out where it wants to drop, then try to drop into the area and paint that line. Now this one carries 4,000 gallons, so it's able to put a pretty good line down as it comes through. So they're doing everything they can to stop this, using every asset available. And now you have to understand there are also the fires in California that these aircraft could be assigned to. So they'll come into this one, work it as much as they can. But if a need comes, then they'll start moving resources around to fight the other fires. But fortunately, just this one and the Ritchie fire, which is, like I said, about 10 miles to the southwest of us here, they're fighting that one as well from the air. But luckily, we're pretty close to San Bernardino Airport, which is a tanker base, so the turnaround time is pretty quick on these very large air tankers to be able to get up here, put down a line, and then come back in on the fire. Now, he's just made a complete loop around the fire and is lining up for this south edge of the fire to continue that Foscheck line that runs on this south flank of the fire. And what they're trying to do, like I said, steer it up into the canyon and then be able to stop it when it gets to the top, because it slows down once it hits the top, and that's where they try to make their stand. They're not going to get them as it works its way uphill, but as it comes down is when they can get at it. But right now the loss of structures in that mobile home park is just unbelievable, and it's no sign of that slowing down at all. So right now they're doing everything they can to fight this. You see a lead aircraft now kind of working its way up the south flank of the fire, and it's going to direct this MD-87 coming. I'm looking for him. He's back out behind me and underneath me. So they're having to deal with a lot of turbulence down low, because when you get lowered to the ground, the wind that's coming across the ground is hitting the hillsides, and it just like water going over a rock, it starts tumbling. And you have up and down drafts, and then the fire itself puts out its own weather system and its own wind patterns that cause turbulence for these firefighters with up and down draft as they go through there. So to bring these big tankers in low and slow like they do takes a lot of skill for these firefighters to pilot these aircraft way above their design to be able to get in here and do that. But the MD-87 just did another high pass. But as we come out now, we can look back right there. You see that circle in the black. Now that's how much is burned. That was all under smoke. And as we come out and pan to the left, you can see how far this fire has gone. You can see that black, all that flash grass just raced up into the canyons here and is burning uphill towards the west. And that's where the main fire is going now. But I don't see much of a fire load ahead of this. So it's getting through the flash area and into this area, you see a little burn here. That's what it does. It hits this flash grass or the really low, heavy grass. It just races up the hills. And then as it does that, it spreads out very quickly and builds a fire line that is they just can't get around. So what they're doing here, this MD-87 is going to come along and paint this side of the fire and try to stop it over here, because that's what they're dealing with, how fast this thing is moving, as well as those helicopters are down in that smoke working that fire. We're never going to see them because they're in the middle of it, dropping water on the areas where structures are threatened and trying to slow it down so the ground crews can work with their hand tools to cut fire lines around any type of structures. But you can see how much it has burned just since we've been here. Right now, it's like you said, it's, I think you said it was 150 acres burned. It was only reported at 20 acres when we arrived. So you see how fast it spread. And you see the that's a lead aircraft coming in. And behind him, you'll have, you see that smoke come out? That's the smoke. They give the indication where they want the FOSDEC dropped. And you're going to see that MD-87 come in with its 4,000 gallons right behind him and get that thing down low and slow. And these aircraft have to even drop their gear, their tires and wheels, to come down and to put out drag to slow them down. You see the gear coming down right there? That is just used for drag so they can slow down and get to the optimal speed, but then still be able to keep power up to keep it flying. So they're getting right on the edge of the power curve as far as it flying. They have the flaps down on the back, slats on the front to give more lift on those wings. And as it comes along, he'll line up on that right where the lead aircraft put out its smoke, and then start doing the drop of that 4,000 gallons of FOSCHECK just to paint that line and cover this south portion. So it's an all-out attack, very well coordinated by the air attack aircraft overhead directing these aircraft in, and also the helicopter control ship down below working to bring aircraft into where they're the best needed and work it through there. So just a really, he turned off, so he didn't have exactly what he wanted, didn't want to drop the load and waste it down here, so he's going to come back around and take another run at it. We see that happen a lot where they'll come down and not like the lineup they have, and then turn off and come back around for another run. So you know, firefighters continue. The hand crews down in there working the fire lines as well as structure protection units in that mobile home park. Another hour on station. Sorry, he just loves hearing himself talk. What? Okay. SC2. Five's up at 7,000 on air. Five, seven, Scotcham. I mean, 7-5, Scotcham, Tehran. Follow you. Five's got nine pass right. You're going to have a jet coming through the left side of your screen. Ives turn it back north. You look up live oak there. There's some things burning up this little road on the north side of the fire. I don't know if that, we can see that at all. Yeah, up that road, up that canyon. Hard to get in there. No good. Coming back around. Five's on the east side going south, crossing the 1075. That same one. 5 is turning back to the north. Seven 37's back. Yeah. If you stay right there, probably fly through your shot. Just at the bottom. No, he just came here. Oh yeah, as soon as we came in for the PM watch, we were headed out here for another fire, the Ritchie fire, and then redirected here to the Calimesa fire. So a lot of activity out here in Riverside. And yeah, they've brought in a lot of the very large air tankers to come in here and fight this fire. That was the 737 you saw fly through the shot. But while you were all speaking, I was kind of working my way around the fire, trying to see how far up the hill it's gone. And it has really gone up through this canyon, working its way to the west. There's still a lot of fire up in the hills as we pan right there, and Colton will show you. This hillside here just caught this edge and racing up that hill. And that flash fuels that we talk about, the flash grass, this is all because of all that rain we had. This grass grows very quickly and up to about knee height and then sits there. Then once the sun comes in and starts baking on it, it dries out very quickly and is very flammable. And the thing about it is, it burns very quickly, so you have a fire that kicks off and spreads very rapidly. And pretty much once a fire gets over 10 acres, it's hard to slow down. And especially with a 30 to 40 mile an hour wind pushing it uphill, it's almost impossible to get ahead of. But you see right here, it's still burning pretty aggressively. You have hand crews right down there on the fire, cutting lines, trying to stop the advancement of this fire. This is on the south border of the fire, and so they're going to try to work on that with hand crews while the big fixed wing work up here in the hills, painting this FOSS check line along the south border of the fire, the south flank of the fire, and keep it from burning any further that way. And they funnel it with that FOSS check up into an uninhabited area to where they can stop it when it hits a ridge top, because that's the areas where they really work on it to stop it as it comes up, because it slows down, and before it can slop over the top, as they call it, they get on it really quickly there and try to stop it. But yeah, they've got it pretty well knocked down here, or not knocked down, but contained on the south border, as I can see with FOSS check line. You see right here this King Air coming through, watching, and that's more than likely a lead aircraft for that 737 that's working through here. I lost track of it as it went underneath us. But you can see the amount of fire that's burned through all that black area here. And right there you have the 737 coming in. As I was speaking earlier, Colson Company just brought these online as fire air tankers being converted from passenger use. There's a large tank that sits up inside the fuselage right along the wings, and that's for the center of gravity. And then the tank goes out the bottom, and you'll see that FOSS-Check come out of the bottom. I don't know exactly how much they carry, but I'm guessing probably in the 4,000 to 6,000 gallon range. And they're able to monitor the drops to be able to slow it down, speed it up, depending on how thick they want the FOSS check to be, because they drop it out in front of the fire and let the fire burn up to it as they continue through. You see, watch that shadow. That is a good indication, Lou and Glenn and Kai, how close it's getting to the ground. This is a passenger aircraft not designed to do this, but these pilots, very skilled to get down low and slow like this and come down with their flaps down, slats down, to give themselves the best chance to fly in there. It looks like he's turning off right up underneath us here. So he was making his lineup and probably just got to a position where he wanted to make a better run at it. So they always do that. They'll come back around. They want to save that FOSS check to use it as best they can and not waste it. And you see he just made a quick turn there back out to the west, and then he'll make another run on an eastbound run here, because that's the way the wind's coming from, and it gives him the best ability to slow down, because the slower he goes, the better line he can lay and the thicker line he can lay. And they want it done like that. They don't want to drop too fast and spread it out to where it drifts off. But you can see swinging back around, didn't take him very long to get reloaded and back. They're coming out of San Bernardino Airport, which is a tanker base for Cal Fire, as well as Victorville, just over the hill through the Cajon Pass. And so they're able to get these big, what they call VLATs, very large air tankers, back serviced and up back up in the air to work on this fire. So he's back up there in the smoke as he works his way down. But they've been working the outer edges as the firefighters, there you see the lead aircraft just came out of the smoke. Here comes the 737 right behind. You'll see the lead aircraft put off that little trail of smoke. That indicates to the pilot of the tanker where he wants that dropped. And once he pops the smoke for him, the tanker then will come in, get down to his drop level, and then start laying that check. But you can see the line right there, the large orange line that works its way down. And what they're going to do is tag on the end. Right there, you see the pop, the smoke come out, and going to tag on the end of this line and just continue painting this line to the east. He's dropping down, and then here it comes as he hits that end, and down it goes, and going to work right across ahead of that fire. And that wasn't a full load right there. I can tell you right now, that was not a full load. He was able to meter his load, drop just a little bit of it, save some, and he's going to come back around and more likely come up and work on an angle off of that line to work up that little road right there, using that as a natural fire break. So that's how these guys work this, with air attack overhead and with the lead aircraft designing a pattern around this fire to try to surround it and direct it into a uninhabited area. And with this grass, it'll burn right up to it and then go out, so they won't have to deal with it anymore. But there's still a lot of fire up in the canyons, working its way west, pretty much between Live Oak and Sandalwood, up in the hills here, just to the south of I-10 through the Calimesa area. Flies back to the north on the east side. See it? Sandalwood or Live Oak? The Bob's big boy? Huh? There's a shopping center here, right here, yeah, right off the edge. That's probably where he's at. That shopping center right there off the freeway. Okay. He's down to that shopping center right there. Got if there's Bob's in there or not. Yeah. It had to be that because the tanker went right over it. 7-5's got you in the turn, pass right when you come out of it. Yeah, 77. Thank you. 5 Sternenbeck south. Right, right. That's how I got here, but I don't think it's, I don't know. That's why I'm going to try to go back. I'm looking at about 35 minutes, 35. That'll be close. Yeah, March might be a better plan. Yeah, they're both the same length from here. Five's coming back to north. They're both 11 miles. So they're both 11 miles. They're going out where the acreage is. They're not going to drop any FosTech around the mobile home park because it's pretty well contained in there. It's black all the way around the mobile home park, so there's no way it's going to get out of there. But they're going to work the south flank here and also that north flank when they're able to get in there. There's just too much smoke on the north side for them to safely fly in there. But they've been working this side here, and once they get this painted and it's contained, they'll start working their way around as best they can when they get opportunities on the north side to be able to stop it from going anywhere further north towards the community. But yeah, this mobile home park right now, it's surrounded by what they call black or burned area, so they're not going to really worry too much about painting any lines around this. Plus they have a lot of assets down there and they have roads that are natural fire breaks for them. But the main thing is trying to get these mobile homes put out, because they just keep springing up as embers get up into the eaves and up into the attics of these homes and burn off. The one we've been watching is the one by that American flag right there. It's been smoking for about the last 45 minutes, And they've been, I don't know if they've been working on the inside. There's a lot of firefighters on the ground right there between them. And so I'm sure they're inside of the hose lines, but it's just really tough to put these things out once they get going. So right now it's just a matter of getting the fire knocked down by the hand in the mobile home park, and then the air tankers work in the flanks of this fire to try to direct it up into the hills and then slow it down and shut it down as it hits the tops. But the smoke is just horrendous out here. It's coming up, blowing out to the northwest, and now it's circling back around north of us, back to the east. So we're getting a swirl going on here that's just obscuring a lot of the sky and not giving them much room to work, working these tankers in here. So right now they're sticking to the south side, which is where the clear air is. But as soon as they get a chance, they'll start working that north side, which borders the 10 freeway, as Chip was showing us from down there at the Bob's. I didn't even see it. That's the black one is 9. Was he on scene altitude? All right. Five's turning back to the south. Now, what do you think? Are you going to march or to? Yeah, I think I got you there. I think that's you, 9. You pass your right, left. A tanker coming down the no, don't worry about it. He's not going to drop. Five's turning back north. Anybody head out to March yet? Okay, good. Yeah, they close at 5, so. It's millionaire out there, right? Or, yeah. Go ahead. March Air Force Base. Now I'm going to guess about 30 to 45. Thought they closed at 5. Matt, you know more better than I do. Five's turning back north, south. Okay. 2300? Good. Six. I got about 20 more minutes, 20 minutes. Okay. Okay. I think they got this thing out, man. Really not a lot up here. Here comes a tanker. Fives on the south side, westbound, turn it back to the east. Ooh. Ooh. That's gonna be five. I got you, and I'll pass you left. I'll turn. Five's turning back south. There's just more homes going up down there. Yeah, we're just watching this continue through the mobile home park here. It looks like it just continues to burn, jumping home to home. And this is in the west portion of that park, and it just, the fire just keeps going through there, and this area right here seems to be the hottest burning part of it, and they're in there with a lot of assets trying to put it down, but unfortunately it's just burning so fast and so quick through those that there's just too much burning right now for them to be able to get a good handle on it. They're also probably having an issue with water, because you get too many tankers or too many engines up in there pulling from the system, it could stress the system and cause it to shut down or not give them the amount of water they need. But they're probably using water tenders to come in and supply those engines so they can fight these fires. But yeah, this west end is still well involved. You see multiple homes there burning. You see a truck right there working the best they can with a hand line. But you see that home right there they're working on is a complete loss, just burned away. They're just trying to keep it from jumping to that tree, which will send it to the house to the left. So they, you know, they're doing everything they can to try to protect it. But this, as we described it earlier, was just a river of fire that came right down the middle of this mobile home park. You can see the path it took as it came away from just a simple grass fire that came up from the east side, got into the mobile home park right here, and then just raced right through, saving, you know, sparing some of the mobile homes, but destroying a lot in its path, and it's still marching through the park here as it works its way to the west, and that's pretty much the furthest west of the that the mobile home park extends. You have a couple more back in there under that heavy smoke, and that's what the firefighters are going to try to protect, but it's going to be very hard for them to do that with this wind coming out of the east, blowing those embers and the fire along the way. Now up in the hills, it is really laid down up there. They've done a great job of funneling this fire. You see the black in the middle there between the two smoke columns right there. That is the north side of the fire by the track, you see. It's working its way. I believe that's Live Oak Canyon Road that goes up that way and works its way up. This is just on the south side of the 10 freeway. And there are some spot fires up the hill, but there's not as much smoke as we've had up here about an hour ago. It started to lay down. We can see more of the ground now from there, but we still have this very stubborn fire in the mobile home park that they're dealing with, and that's going to be going for quite a while because they just can't get in there to fight that fire and without that many homes on fire at once. So right now that's where they're focusing the ground attack, but the air tankers are still doing their work along the right and left flank of this fire as it works its way up the canyon to the west. They're still pretty stiff. We're getting blown pretty good up here. I'm having to do as I described. I have to kind of crab into the wind or turn into the wind just to get a straight track back and forth. But luckily, they're smooth up at our altitude. We're at 8,000 feet to give the firefighting aircraft room to work down below. And so we're above the turbulence that's caused by the terrain as that wind works its way across the low foothills and it tumbles as it comes over the top of those hills. But up where we're at, it's nice and smooth for us, luckily. And hopefully it sticks that way because this part of town, it can get really rough up here when that wind starts coming out of the northeast over the hills coming down through this area. But right now it's still blowing very hard, but very smooth for us up here in Sky 5. But it's not the same for those firefighter in the helicopters down there on the fire line. Turn it back north. I just got Alpha Papa out to my east. I'll be turning back to the north. find a trash truck if you can. I don't know. Nothing's burned away from there, though. Nah. It's probably going to be back there by the Bob's Big Boy area. But there you go, yep. There you go. Yeah, man. How far am I? Turn around. Five turn back south. Right, right. Five's up above you to your left. I can't see it, so. Okay, five's out of here to March. Going to March, going to March. Okay.